Hi friends, good morning. I am Dr. N. John Jabratnam, HOD, Department of Science and Humanities, Jerusalem College of Engineering, which is situated in Chennai near Vedachery. Jerusalem College of Engineering is one of the top engineering colleges in Chennai, accredited by NBA and NAC, and we are celebrating the Silver Jubilee this year. Today, Physics Department of our college presenting a webinar on fascinating phase singularities. The speaker of the webinar is Dr. Deeba. Dr. Deeba completed her doctorate degree from Anna University, Chennai. She has published many papers in national and international journals. She got 9 years of teaching experiences in various colleges. Currently, she is a Women Scientist Fellow in the Department of Physics, Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi. Now I request Dr. Deeba to take over the session. Welcome, madam.
Good morning to everyone. Thank you, sir, for your kind words. Now we'll talk about fascinating phase singularities. I'll just take you through a ride of what phase singularities are and what are the important features of these phase singularities and why are they so interesting. So the outline of the talk will be introduction to singularities, phase singularities, the characteristics of phase singularities, how do we generate the optical vortices, and what is the importance about orbital angular momentum associated with it and the applications of phase singularities. So coming to the introduction, first we'll see what singular optics is. Singular optics is a branch of physics which deals with the study of structured light, which includes localized and extended singularities. So what do we mean by structured light? We can actually design how we want the light to look like. So but before that, we should know what a singularity means. So singularity is most commonly used in mathematics. So in mathematics, singularity is actually defined as a point at which a given mathematical quantity is not defined. In other words, a point where the mathematical quantity is not well behaved or blows up in some particular way. So this makes analysis of that point difficult. So coming to physics. In physics, singularity exists when any of the parameter required to define any physical function is undefined. We know that any physical function has so many parameters associated with it. So if any one or many of these parameters are not defined at one particular point, then we say singularity exists at that point. So in optics, what do we mean by phase singularities? We know that electromagnetic fields are defined by parameters like amplitude, phase, whatever. So when a point at which any of these parameters required to describe the electromagnetic field becomes undefined or indeterminate, then we call it a singularity, and it is also called as singular points. So what is the interest in these singular points? Why do we want to study these singular points? We know that human nature is, if anything goes by routine, or if we have a person who follows a disciplined, normal daily routine, then that person is not considered to be an interesting person. But if you have somebody who has an erratic life schedule, like you don't know what is going to happen next, then that kind of lifestyle is interesting to study or look into. So that is why here also in phase singular points, even though that particular point is not well defined, the neighborhood points are characterized by very large gradients leading to some interesting observations which make them important. So we'll see what actually a singularity means by in simpler terms. So we know, like in a globe, you have all latitudes and longitudes which are all virtual. So in along the longitudes, we have the time to be different. Each longitude has different times. So here what happens is, when you take the pole, so which time do we associate the pole to have? So all the longitudes come and join at the pole. So the time at the pole is indeterminate. This is what we mean by a singularity. And singularity is not something imaginary. It is all around us in different forms in nature. So that is what we see here. The first one shows you a leaf structure. You have eye of a cyclone, the shape of shells, the tendrils which are spiraling, and you have the flapping of wings of a bee, which helps in one way or the other to keep it afloat in the air. Then we see a tornado, then there is a whirlpool and an insect moving through water, like creating singularities around it. So these are all some examples that exist in nature around us, and there are many such examples. And one more interesting example like that is wingtip vortices. So this is when an aeroplane takes off. If there is a cloudy condition, then sometimes we'll be able to notice this wingtip vortices. So if the aircraft has flat wings, what happens is you will have the wingtip vortices formed, and you see that on either side, the handedness of the vortices are different. So each side it is different, and this will create a drag to the flight of the aeroplane. So what it done is, you have small winglets placed along with the flat wings of the aircraft to minimize this drag. And it is also very dangerous sometimes, because if there is a small flight going near this big flight, and there is a turbulence because of that, it can also topple the small flight nearby. So these are some interesting singularities. And we have now coming to singularities in optics. In optics, we generally talk about two types of singularities. One is a phase singularity and the polarization singularity. The phase singularities are associated with scalar optics, and the polarization singularities come with vector optics. So we will here talk only about the phase singularities, which are having many things to discuss. And course, the polarization singularities are a little advanced, and we'll not go into it in this particular lecture. And now talking about electromagnetic waves, light is associated with different parameters, as we said already. And the most important parameters are amplitude, phase, and polarization. But when we talk only about scalar optics, polarization components are negligible. So we will have only amplitude and phase to be important parameters. So if any parameter of this, and particularly the phase, is indeterminate, then we talk about phase singularity. And when polarization also puts its hand into it, then we talk about polarization singularities. As I said earlier, we will talk only about phase singularities in this lecture. So now, the most common form of wave that we know is the Gaussian wave. So this Gaussian wave is given by this particular equation, where the important parameters are the beam spot, beam waste, radius of curvature, and Gaussian phase. I understand that most of the audience will be first year students, so I'm not going into much of equations or mathematical concepts. I would try to keep my talk simple and interesting, keeping away from mathematics. So here, when we see the Gaussian wave, we have a peak seen, and this peak is showing a high intensity at the center, and it trails off, the intensity trails off along the edges. And if you see, the wave front will be a plane wave front, and the phase structure will look like what is shown in the figure, and it will be a uniform phase front. So the phase is uniform at any point you talk about. And here, the wavefront is a plane wavefront, and this color of the phase structure has nothing to do with anything. It is only for the contrast for this background. But when we consider the phase singularities, we are talking about optical vortices here. The phase singularities are also called as optical vortices because they have a vortex structure. Vortex is nothing but a rotational motion of matter. So here, the optical vortices are having a null amplitude in the middle, followed by high intensity, and again we see the null amplitude. The red color talks about zero amplitude, zero intensity, and the yellow is showing the maximum intensity. So this will be the intensity profile of a phase singularity, and this optical vortex is also called as a donut beam, or it is actually the zero of an optical field. As we have told earlier, optical phase singularity is a point where the phase is indeterminate and the amplitude is zero. Does that mean that any beam which is having a null intensity at the center is a phase singularity or encloses a phase singularity? Not necessarily. Any beam which is having a null amplitude at the middle should not necessarily enclose a phase singularity. We'll see that. Well, then what is the essential condition for being a phase singularity or enclosing a phase singularity? But that is given here. So when you are considering any non-singular beam that is traveling a circular path, then for that particular beam, closed integral of del phi dot dl, which is the phase gradient and the line element, is equal to zero. But for the phase singular beams, this integral is not zero. What does that mean? This means that the curl of the phase gradient is not equal to zero, and hence in the neighborhood of the singularity, the gradient field will have circulating phase gradient. So only at that particular singular point, you will have zero amplitude and you will have the phase to be indeterminate. But around the singularity, if you see the neighborhood, you will have a circulating phase gradient. So now this optical vortex or a phase singularity is also a point phase defect, and it can also be taken as a screw dislocation, for those who know the meaning of these words. And we are talking about continuous wavefront here, because if you take in the case of a Gaussian beam, and if the Gaussian beam is propagating, what happens is at any particular instance you will have single separate wavefronts. But that is not the case with an optical vortex, where you have a continuous wavefront being spun through the entire propagation distance. So you see here that the wavefront is continuous and not separate wavefronts, and the distance between, you see here three helixes, and the difference between any two is lambda, distance between any two actually. And the phase structure of a optical vortex is shown here. You know that, or you remember that for a Gaussian beam, the phase structure was uniform, the phase was uniform throughout. But here you see that a phase structure is a little different. So at the center, where you see a point, that is the phase singularity. So there only you have the amplitude null. Why? Because when you, and this side, the right side, which is showing the dark, is the zero phase, and the left side, which is showing light green, entire light green, is the 2π. So when you take the anti-circular motion, like anti-clockwise motion, you are moving from 0 to 2π slowly, slowly. So if you are considering radial lines along every radial line, the phase has one particular value. But when all these lines, equiphase lines, meet at the center, the center phase becomes indeterminate, as we have seen in the case of the time at the poles. So this phase structure is got when you actually take a cross section of this wavefront at any particular time. The phase structure and the optical topological charge of the phase singularities are very important. We have topological charge associated with every phase singularity. The topological charge M of an optical vortex is given by M is equal to 1 by 2 pi closed integral del phi by del phi dot dl, where del phi is the phase gradient and dl is the line element. C is nothing but a small closed curve that we consider around the vortex core. And this topological charge need not be positive. It can be positive and negative. It can take any integer values. So that is what we see here. If we consider vortices with mod M is equal to 1, first one shows you a negative singularity and the second one shows you a positive singularity. And the phase map is shown in the right side, where you have the dark portion to be 0 and the light bright portion to be 2π. So the phase slowly changes from 0 to 2π. So how do we now say if it is a positive singularity or a negative singularity? This we can say, as I said earlier, always the sense of rotation that we take by default is the anticlockwise sense of rotation. So when we move anticlockwise, if we are moving from 0 to 2π, then the vortex is a positive vortex. And if we are moving from 2π to 0 anticlockwise direction, then we call it as a negative vortex. Now, why do we say that a vortex is associated with a charge? As I said earlier, in your phase structure, you see radial equiphase lines. So these phase contour lines are in along every contour, you will have the same phase value. So these phase contour lines are similar to electric field lines, which start from the positive charge and end at the negative charge. So that is why here also we have charge associated with a singularity. And here also we talk about charge conservation. There are rules like sign rule be followed whenever we talk about all these things. And these can take integer values or fractional vortices are also present. Now this is how a vortex structure is present. The optical vortices are actually represented by psi is equal to A e power I m phi, m theta or m phi whatever. this A is the amplitude part and exponential part is the phase part. And M gives you the topological charge of the phase singularity. Now, this Lx is giving you the orbital angular momentum of the light associated. So here when you see, you see five different rows. The center row that you see is M is equal to zero, which is representing your normal Gaussian beam TEM 00 mode. And you see the brightness at the center. So this is the intensity profile of a Gaussian beam that we know already. So as you go up, you have M is equal to one charge and M is equal to two charge. And as you go down, you have minus one and minus two charge. And the corresponding wavefronts are shown in the left side, where you have air, where you see, as I told you, in the Gaussian wave, you will have separate plane wavefronts as the wave propagates. But when you take a vortex, the wavefronts will be continuously propagating. So that we can see here clearly. And the first one is like M is equal to one, you have a helical structure. For M is equal to two, you have a double helical structure and so on. And you see that whenever you have a phase singularity, you have a donut beam or a vortex beam. So this vortex beam was actually first studied in 1970s only, but this concept of OAM came very late. So we know what that time it was like, vortex is having a hole in the middle of the beam. But it is actually not really a hole, but rather an area where out-of-phase mini waves overlap and cancel each other out as they spin around the center of the beam. So this gives you a close picture of how the wavefronts are for a Gaussian beam. M is equal to one vortex and M is equal to two vortex or a phase singularity. So M and L are, like I am using M and L in the same context. Here also L is here. Topological charge. And the first row gives you the intensity profile of this, and the second row gives you the phase profile. So you see that when L is equal to 0, you have 0 to 2 pi being traversed twice. So now, how do we generate these optical vortices? So these optical vortices are generated by many different methods, and the most common method and effective method is the use of a spiral phase plate, which is called as an SPP. So this SPP has a staircase structure. Now, to know why the SPP has a staircase structure, we should know more about the wavefront of the helical beam. So actually, when you take a non-singular beam, what happens is when you are taking a closed circular path, if you start from one point and you take a closed circular path, at the end of that one circular motion, you will come and end at the same point. This is for a non-singular beam. But in the case of a singular beam or a optical vortex, what happens is you would have traversed a height lambda above or below. It is like going one floor above or one floor below when you take one particular closed trajectory. So this is the nature of the wavefront of a phase singularity. So to generate that, you have an SPP also designed in such a way. So when you have an SPP, you see that it has a staircase structure. So if you have like a vortex of charge 1, then you can say that one, when you traverse one closed path, you will go from the ground floor to the first floor. It can be above or you can go to underground also. So that is when we're talking about the positive vortex or the negative vortex, moving up or moving down. And when you have and the height traveled is lambda. When you have higher charges, you have the height traversed to be equal to L into lambda. So that height is traversed. So here this shows you M is equal to one charge only. So one side you have the Gaussian beam when it is passed through an SPP. On the other side, you generate the optical vortex or the helical beam. And the same SPP can be used to generate positive vortex and the negative vortex. How do we do that? Consider that the beam path, you have the SPP in between. You are sending the beam from this side to this side. So when the TEM wave or the Gaussian beam travels through the point in the SPP here and goes this side, you will have a positive vortex generated. In the same setup, if you are sending the input beam from the other side, then when you have the output from this side, it will create your negative vortex. So this is how SPP is used in the generation of both positive and negative vortices. And you see that here, L is equal to 1 and L is equal to minus 1 have different sense of rotations of the wavefront, which is clearly shown in the slide. And here also we see that the staircase structure of SPP is clearly seen, which has different phase at different points. And the height that is achieved at the end of the closed travel is also clearly seen. And there are other methods of generations of optical vortices also. But the first one we saw is the spiral phase plate or the SPP. There are interferometric methods for generation of optical vortices. You can use a 4 grating. The 4 grating that is shown in the slide has only 1/4. So this creates, when exactly the Gaussian beam is traveled to this 4 point, it will give you optical vortex of charge 1. Depending on how much 4 you are using, you can get higher order vortices also. And then you have the spatial light modulator. The spatial light modulator is shown below the slide. It is nothing but a liquid crystal device. It has liquid crystal device where the liquid crystals can be modulated with respect to the phase. So what happens is it is connected to a computer. You can give whatever phase structure you want to be imparted to the beam to the computer. So when the beam passes through the SLM, the wave that is reflected from the SLM takes that particular wave phase structure that you want the wave to take. It is imparted to the wave, and the reflected wave will have the nature of wave that you want. This is a way to create structured light. And here, what structure are we creating? We are creating a donut structure. And you have adaptive helical mirrors also to be helpful in generating optical vortices. And you also have S wave plates or Q wave plates, which are used in the same sense in different literature papers. S wave plates are actually nothing but spatially varying half wave plates, where you have at every point, it is having 8 segments or something. And each segment, the half wave plate will be in one particular orientation. So the orientation keeps on changing along the 8 segments. So this is one example of S wave plate. There are different charges that can be generated using an S wave plate also. So now we have seen how we generate optical vortices. Then next we are going to see it, what particular characteristic of the optical vortex makes it very interesting and useful in many, many different fields. So for that, keeping in mind the audience, I'm just going rushing through the momentum basics so that we understand this concept better, which is more important. So here we have to talk about linear momentum first. We know what linear momentum is. Linear momentum describes the strength of an object. When an object is stationary, there is not going to be any linear momentum, because linear momentum we know to be a product of M into V. So if you have V is equal to 0, like for a object that is at rest, V is equal to 0, so there is no momentum. So momentum is associated only with a moving object. So linear momentum is associated with any object that moves in a straight line. But when the object moves around in circles, or it is precessing like a top, not moving in a straight line, then you have angular momentum associated with the object. So in space also, we see angular momentum very commonly when we study stars, planets, spiral galaxies, nebulae, even black holes. They all spin, and without anything to stop their spin, they will keep on spinning. So this angular momentum is actually a vector, because you have a direction associated with the motion of the object. And the angular momentum magnitude is given by, of an orbiting object is given by mvr. You know mv is a linear momentum. You are multiplying the linear momentum by r, where r is a perpendicular distance from the center of rotation to a line drawn in the direction of its instantaneous motion passing through the object's center of gravity. There is another formula also from where we get the angular momentum, which is I omega, where I is the moment of inertia of the rotating body or the system, and omega is the angular velocity of the rotating body of the system. So now, whenever we talk about sports activities, we have this angular momentum playing a very important role. When you talk about moving in a merry-go-round or doing this fine kind of dance form or just a slingshot, whatever, you talk about angular momentum. So now, how is this angular momentum classified? Coming into our picture, angular momentum is generally classified into two important components. One is the spin angular momentum, and the other one is the orbital angular momentum, which is called as OAM. Now, the spin angular momentum is associated with left or right circular polarization, and the OAM is associated with the helical wavefront. For better understanding, for easier understanding, let us consider Earth that we already know. Earth is spinning about its own axis and is also orbiting around the sun in the planet system. So, solar system. So, what happens is, due to its daily rotation about its axis, Earth is associated with a SAM or a spin angular momentum. And because of its annual revolution about the sun, it is having a OAM. This is the easy way of understanding and remembering what SAM and OAM are. So now that we say that SAM is associated with right circular polarization or left circular polarization, whatever, we have to have a glimpse of what polarization is. We know polarization is nothing but the oscillation of electric field as the electromagnetic wave moves. And homogeneous polarization has three common polarizations: linear polarization, circular polarization, and elliptical polarization. So now, elliptical polarization is the most general form. Linear polarization and circular polarization are the extremes of this elliptical polarization. For example, how do I say this? When the ellipticity becomes zero, then you get linear polarization. When you have the A and B to be equal to A to be equal to B, then you get a circular polarization in an ellipse. So these are the homogeneous forms of polarization. What do I mean by homogeneous polarizations? When you take any wavefront, all across the wavefront, any point that you see will have the same polarization. If it is linear, it can be vertical or horizontal. Throughout the wavefront, it is going to be the same vertical wave polarization or horizontal wave polarization. And when we talk about circular polarization also, throughout the entire wavefront, you are going to have the same polarization throughout. And then what do we mean by inhomogeneous polarization? Inhomogeneous polarization is, as you see in the slide, you take any wavefront, you see that at any spatial point that you take, the oscillation of the electric field is different in different direction, different points. So first one, you see azimuthal polarization, where if you have seen the skew rays in fiber optics, then you will be familiar with this type of movement of a beam. So here you have azimuthal polarization like this, and the below one shows you the radial polarization, where the oscillations are radially varying throughout the entire wavefront. So now, talking about spin angular momentum, you know that circular polarization can be right circular polarization or left circular polarization, depending on which side the circle is going to move. which side the circle is tracing as the beam propagates. So the angular momentum due to the circular polarization is spin angular momentum. So as you know, there can be only two different types of circular polarization, which is light circular or left circular. So only two values associated with the spin angular momentum, which can be +1 or -1. So these are extrema values. One is for right circular polarization RCP and the other one is for left circular polarization LCP. So the spin angular momentum arising due to polarization associated with one particular photon is given by sigma into H. That Z is only talking about the propagation direction, which we always consider to be the Z direction. Now coming to the orbital angular momentum. The orbital angular momentum, as I said earlier, even though the vortex was found in 1970s itself, this concept of orbital angular momentum being associated with a vortex beam was found only in 1992. From then on, this field has gained a lot of momentum and there are so much of research. And in just 1 year or so, there were like nearly 1,000 papers published on this particular space singularities itself. It became so important after the advent of or the invention of this OAM being associated with the space singularity. So in 1992, Allen et al. Successfully twisted light and demonstrated how a photon within it would share the beams OAM. They recognized that the light beams with an azimuthal phase dependence of exponential I L phi, which we have seen already as I M phi, whatever, carry an orbital angular momentum. And this orbital angular momentum can be many times larger than SAM. Why? Because L can take all integer values which are possible, but SAM can take only two values, +1 or -1. Such a beam, the mini waves rotate around the center of the beam as a helix, in the form of a helix. We know that optical vortex has a helical structure associated with it. A perpendicular cross section looks like a donut. This also we have seen already. The light around a seemingly empty center. So this OAM has unlimited number of possible states, as I told earlier, because it corresponding to all the integer values of L. Now, The OAM arises whenever a beam's phase fronts are not perpendicular to the general propagation direction. So this means that the transverse components of the propagation vectors are present along with the perpendicular component. So common form of helically phased beam that we come across is the Lager-Gaussian beam. Lager-Gaussian beam, I think after Gaussian beams, Lager-Gaussian beam is a very common word that many people know. So this is this beam are supposed to have donor structure, vortex structure, and the other beams which are having helical wavefront are Bessel beams, Matthew beams, Innes Gaussian beams, etc. These are all like exotic beams which are not very commonly used. They are mostly used in fiber optics, and Lager-Gaussian is used very commonly in many fields. The plane wavefronts with characteristic inhomogeneous polarization distribution can also carry OAM. It is not necessary that only scalar wavefronts with a helical structure should have OAM. So now we are having an idea of what phase singularity is, what is the intensity of how does the intensity profile of a phase singularity look, how the phase structure looks, how it can be generated by differentiators, and what are the angular momentums associated with these are the characteristic angular momentum associated with the phase singularities. Now, using this, the phase singularities have found applications in very many fields, and we'll just see about some fields out of these. The first one is collimation testing, spiral interferometry, isotropic edge enhancement, optical vortex coronagraph, STED microscopy, optical trapping and tweezers, optically driven micromotors in communication and in phase retrieval. In some of these, the OAM concept comes into use, and in some of these, OAM concept is not put into use. Now let us see the first application, collimation testing with phase singularities. Why is collimation very important? Those who have done optical experiments will know what is the importance of beam collimation is. How do you get a collimated beam? You have a point source. The point source is emanating light in all directions. You put a spatial filter over it, like on its way, then spatially filter the beam so that you get a clean, uniform beam. Then you keep a lens, and if you keep a lens at the focal point, then you will have the beam to be collimated. That is, parallel beams are rendered. But if the lens position is not correct, if it is moving either side, this side or that side, you will have the beam to be converging or diverging. You will not get a plane wavefront. In that case, you will not get the desired output that you want out of optical experiments. So beam collimation is very, very important, and it is mostly related to the accuracy of measurements. So now, a plane wave generated when a point, so this is what I told, the plane wave generated when point source is at focal point, a plane of the collimating lens, you have parallel rays being rendered. So the general method, how you test if there is a proper collimation or there is no collimation, is using interference method only, which was done for very many long years. And the interference fringes are generally observed to monitor the disturbance in the collimation. How do we do that? For example, if you are interfering a plane wave with another collinear reference plane wave, you will get a no fringe condition. But if you are not getting a no fringe condition, if there is a disturbance in collimation, what will you get? You will get concentric circular fringes. And the same way, in shear interferometer also, when you have collimated condition, when you are interfering two plane waves, you will get no fringe condition. But in case of disturbance in collimation, you will get straight line fringes. So the formation or the observation of these fringes show that the collimation has been disturbed. But the direction of defocus remains unknown. You just know that there is a problem with the collimation. You have to do the experiment from the first again, but you don't know which direction the lens should be moved easily. But if you use orbit optical vortex or the phase singularities, then what happens is when you are interfering an optical vortex or a helical wave with a plane wave, helical wave having charge M, you get M radial fringes instead of no fringe condition. Then what happens when there is disturbance in the collimation? You will have M spiral fringes. The radial fringes become spiral fringes. In the figures given below, the center one shows you proper radial fringes when there is proper collimation And the reason to this is, like when you have disturbance, what happens is the plane wave front no longer remains plane, it becomes spherical. So when a spherical wave is interfering with a helical wave, you get spiral fringes. So this is how it is done. So what is the hype about it? What is the importance of this? When you see the, like when you have observation of these spiral fringes, you can see that you can have diverging, if you have a diverging beam interfering with the optical vortex, you get spiraling in one direction. And for a converging beam, the spiraling is in the opposite direction. So seeing the direction of spirals, you can know which the defocusing is in which direction. It is before the lens or after the lens. So this makes things very easier and clear. So coming to the second important application, this is in image processing. You know, image processing is a very, very important field where you have to retrieve images from what all small informations you have, which is very difficult actually. And edge enhancement is one of the image processing techniques which is important. Why do we talk about edges? When we have to know about any object, the edges play an important part in knowing or giving information about the object. So the edges have to be properly found or observed actually. So what is the general procedure done? You are generally for general procedures that were followed were optical Fourier transform techniques. So what you do there, you filter out the low spatial frequency components and study what, and then try to retrieve the edges out of it. And for that, you use SLM, spatial light modulator, or mechanical spatial filters for this purpose. And the concept that is used is one-dimensional Hilbert transform. What are we doing in this one-dimensional Hilbert transform? Hilbert transform is actually a signum function, and the transmittance function of it gives you a step profile. And to get a step profile, actually what we do is you take a transparent glass plate and you have the glass plate to be half transparent, and on the other half you coat it with a coating. So it becomes half transparent and half coated. So the coating side, when the beam comes and falls on this glass plate, the coating side retards the wave by pi radians with respect to the uncoated side. So this is how you actually get the step profile that is necessary. So now the step profile is got and the plate has produced a edge dislocated wave. So now this filter is placed in the Fourier plane of a 4F system. You know what a 4F system is. The 4F system is given here for refresh, like revising kind, whatever. You have two lenses and you see what after the object. The object is placed at the focal plane of the lens, one side of the focal plane of the lens. And in the other side, you have the back focal plane. In the back focal plane, you have placed the filter in the middle, where you see two points coming and merging. In that particular point, you will keep your filter so that you get the image in the back focal plane of the second lens. So this is a normal usual 4F system that is being used for imaging. So when you keep this Hilbert transform filter, 1D Hilbert transform filter in this particular center, it will give you an extra phase of pi, two phase spatial frequency components in the frequency half plane, depending on the orientation of the phase jump. What do we mean by that? If you see this diagram, there are two binary phase masks shown. The first one has a phase jump in the horizontal direction. One is coated, one side is coated and the other side is not coated. And the second phase mask shows the jump in the horizontal. First one is vertical direction, the second one is a horizontal direction. So this extra phase of pi is given. So what is the result of it? The filter image is edge enhanced in the direction perpendicular to the edge dislocation direction. So if you want to identify edges in one particular direction, you keep the filter in one particular direction. If you want to detect the other edges, you will have to rotate the filter in that particular Fourier plane. So for enhancing edges in each direction, so you are going to use a different filter, or you are going to rotate the filter and use. But if you are going to use a vortex face mask as a spatial filter in the 4F geometry, this gives you symmetric edge enhancement in all the directions. What is the reason for that? The phase profile that you know for an optical vortex shows phase difference of m pi along any radial line with respect to the vortex core. You can ask, like, if you are having a filter in x direction, if you are having another filter in y direction, why not after filtering it using x direction, then put the y direction filter sequentially so that you will get the isotropic edge enhancement. This is not possible in 1D Hilbert transform, which I'll show you why. But in the case of using optical vortices or the phase singularities, this isotropic edge enhancement is possible. If you want anisotropic edge enhancement also, it can be done using optical vortices. So now we'll see how it is done. You are considering an input object, which is actually a binary object. What do I mean by a binary object? You have only darkness or brightness, which is present in the projector slide. Serves as an object. So the input object is a binary object. You are having two binary face masks, one in the horizontal direction and one in the vertical direction. As I said, a normal transparent glass plate is coated on one side and left transparent on the other side. And when you are doing filtering through these binary phase masks, in the first case, you see that you are getting edges enhanced along the vertical direction alone. There is no edge enhancement in the horizontal direction. When you rotate the mask and use it, then you will get edge enhancement along the horizontal direction alone, but not in the vertical direction. So as I said earlier, keeping the two masks sequentially is not going to help us in any way. It is not going to give you isotropic edge enhancement. What will happen in that case? You will get something like this, which is not going to help us in any way. But in the case of a vortex mask that is shown, you would have been used to the phase profile by now. When you are using this as a vortex mask, then you get isotropic edge enhancement, which has clear edge enhancement in all directions. As I said earlier, if you want anisotropic also, you can accordingly design the mask and get anisotropic edge enhancement also using a vortex mask. So this is what we see image processing in a amplitude object. The same thing or edge enhancement can be done in phase objects also, which is more difficult than getting edge enhancement in amplitude objects. So for that, we have to know what amplitude objects are and what phase objects are, what is the difference between them. So amplitude objects are those which change the amplitude and therefore the intensity of transmitted or reflected light. Normal samples that we use, projector slides. The phase objects are generally transparent objects or samples, most commonly biological samples. Most of the biological samples are transparent, which makes image processing very difficult. These do not affect the optical intensity. Instead, they generate a phase shift in the transmitted or reflected light. So what happens is getting the edges of these transparent objects becomes very, very difficult, which you can see in the bright field imaging that is normally used. The amoeba is not at all clearly seen, but when the optical vortex is used in case of phase contrast imaging here, you see the edges are clearly seen so that you can have an idea of how the object actually is. Now, this is also used in the field of metrology. Generally, interferograms are used for optical testing. Metrology is also a very wide field. We are just going to see one particular example how it is used for optical testing. So now, light reflected or transmitted by an object, when it is interfering with a reference plane wave, you get closed contour lines. Now, we are just thinking about an object which has a smooth profile, a smooth surface. So in that case, when the light is reflected or transmitted through that particular object, if it is interfering with the reference plane wave, you will get closed contour lines. And the closed fringes enclose the extremum point. So these contour lines, what do the contour lines mean? Every contour lines gives an idea of the height of the object at that particular point. And it is always enclosing a extremum point. So what is the problem with normal existing methods? The limitation is the same contours are got irrespective of the enclosed point being a peak or valley. We said that extremum point is enclosed within the contour lines. So even if the extremum point is a peak or a valley, you get the same closed contour lines. So it is not at all helpful. We are not going to know whether the object is having a lift, like height in the surface, or it is dipping. So for example, what happens is, whenever you have a convex surface interfering, a convex wave front interfering with the plane wave, you will get concentric ring pattern. And the same pattern is got when a concave surface is interfering with a plane wave. So to distinguish, to see whether it is a peak or a valley, you have to put in extra efforts or extra techniques have to be used, like fringe shifting technique. Then only you can distinguish whether it is a peak or a valley. But when you have spiral interferometry, which uses optical phase singularities, then this detection becomes simple. It has been made simple by the use of phase singularities. How? How is, like, when you have, this is what we have seen already, when you have a converging wave, like interfering with a plane wave, you get concentric circles, concentric contours. When you have the diverging wave interfering with a plane wave also, you get the same thing. You are not able to distinguish between these two interferograms. Clear? Correct? But in the case of a helical wave, what happens is you will get spirals, as we have seen already in the collimation testing. So here, interference between helical wave with converging or diverging waves gives spiral fringes, but the direction of spiraling will distinguish whether it is a concave wavefront or a convex wavefront, concave surface or a convex surface. And optical thickness variation of any sample is easily analyzed. This is the easiest case that we are seeing. Consider a case where you will have an example which has thickness of the sample is not very smooth. You are having peaks and valleys in it. So if you see here in this normal interferogram, how many closed contours do you see? You see 4 different closed contours. And you can say that there are 2 peaks, 2 valleys, or 3 peaks, 1 valley, whatever. But you cannot surely say whether it is a peak or a valley that is being present along the entire surface of the sample. So this is a normal interferogram. But when you use a spiral interferogram in this case, what happens? You see that in 2 cases, the spiraling is in, it's towards the center. And the other 2 cases, the spiraling is away from the center. So you know that there are 2 peaks and 2 valleys in this particular sample surface. So this is how phase singularities are very helpful in studying the surface of any samples. Now, till now, we have seen all the applications which have not taken into account the orbital angular momentum concept or the property associated with the phase singularity. But when we talk about orbital angular momentum, then there are other uses which makes use of this property of OAM, for like this, where you have an array of optically driven micro motors present. So you see here, you see there are small motors, and with the impact, like when you impart the OAM of the beam to these, you are able to rotate the particles as you want. So this kind of application has also been reported. Now, the next important use of phase singularities is in communication. So when you talk about OAM again, we will refresh what all we have seen already. An OAM beam with lowest level of twist will have a phase profile which spans only from 0 to 360 degrees or 0 to 2 pi as you trace a circle around the center of the beam along the across the axis. So the beams with higher values of OAM have multiple cycles of phase change. If you see here in the right side, you see that 0 to 2 pi here corresponds to blue to red. And if you see when you have charge 2, this blue to red occurs twice. If you see in charge 3, the blue to red occurs thrice. So this is how you can differentiate, or you can say what is the charge of the OAM beam actually. And you also see that the size of the donut goes on increasing as the topological charge of the beam goes on increasing. That is also another factor which you can with respect to intensity itself, you can say. But if you have only one beam, you cannot say that. If you are going to move along OAM beams having different charges, you can say which charge is more than the other. And OIM produces a clear visible effect in cross-section, a donut strain that is seen. So these points we have seen already. The next thing which we have not seen is the OIM beams are orthogonal to each other. What do you mean by orthogonal to each other? Why is it important? You know that if two beams are to interfere, they cannot be orthogonal. Orthogonal beams do not interfere. So when the OIM beams are orthogonal to each other, this is a good news for communication because you will not have interference of signals when you are sending data through these beams. This means that each beam is distinct. So this orthogonality means that OIM beams can occupy the same space without interfering with one another. It is theoretically possible to use an infinite number of beams, each with a different value of OIM, to carry signals. So this is a major step forward in the terms of optical communications. In 2004, a physicist called Miles Paget and his colleagues showed OIM beams could be used to encode data by using different values of OIM to represent information. Up to about 8 OIM beams have been sent through the same channel without any interference through a small distance and shown. And this can also be used in modulation. The simplest thing is on-off keying, where you have for representing zeros and ones, the beam can be present or absent. This is the simplest form of modulation using an OIM beam. Then, how was the transmittance done for an OIM beam? The transmittance was done like this. The transmitter generates regular laser beams produced from a source, and these beams are passed through a spatial light modulator. So you generate helical beams of different charges. So based on the liquid crystal, the SLM imparts a twist to the beam. And receiving end, what you have to do is each OIM beam was converted back into the regular wave by passing it through again through a spatial light modulator, which is having an inverse pattern. And then the data could be retrieved at the receiver end by conventional means. So what was the importance of this demonstration? It was able to demonstrate that free space communication is possible using a beams carrying OIM, in spite of having random variations in air pressure and temperature. Then, in not only in ordinary communication, in quantum communication also phase singularities find their place. Not only phase singularities, polarization singularities also for that matter, but since we are not going into those details, we'll just see how they have influenced this field also. So in quantum communication, which can be used to send information far more securely than traditional systems do, you can also take advantage of OIM. Today, quantum bits or qubits, actually they are sending information in the form of qubits only, quantum bits they are called as, can be made of photons that are constructed from a superposition of two possible polarization states, which are vertical and horizontal. Here we see that with respect to vertical and horizontal polarization states itself, they are far more better than the usual or conventional quantum communication techniques. With the advent of polarization singularities, more and more structured polarized beams can be designed. And in that case, this possibility of having more and more beams to be sent without interference becomes multifold. But OIM is also a quantum, OIM is not only a property of the beam as such, it is also a quantum property of single photons. So Robert Boyd of the University of Rochester in New York has pioneered in demonstration of quantum communication systems. He has shown that a single photon can have many possible values of OIM, which can be used to increase the capacity of a quantum link. Now we'll see another interesting application of phase singularities. Again, this also uses OIM concept. You can say it uses also, because with OIM, the use becomes different than without OIM. So optical tweezers, you know, optical tweezers are very important because they got Nobel Prize for the person who talked about it first, Arthur Ashkin. So in 2018, the Nobel Prize was given to this person, was shared to this person also for his work describing tools made of light. Why do we call them tools made of light? Because optical tweezers are like, you know what normal tweezer is. Like, what is a tweezer? A tweezer is a small instrument which can pick small objects. or they are used for, like, they are very small. You can also think of small size forceps. So these are optical tweezers where light is used as a tweezer to pin down or immobilize a microscopic object using a physical force. So you, for that you require a highly focused beam. So you generally use high NA, large NA objectives for this. And this field is very important because it not only revolutionized physics, it also revolutionized chemistry and biology in its own way. The basic principle behind optical tweezers is the momentum transfer associated with the bending light. A laser beam is focused by a high quality microscope objective to a high quality, and the value is also high, NA is also high generally, to a spot in a specimen plane. This spot actually creates an optical trap which is able to hold a small particle. Generally, the particles that are held in are in the form of beads, spherical in nature. It was first shown in spherical, like trapping of spherical particles only. And the most common ones that are trapped are the polystyrene beads at its center. And when you want to manipulate particles, later so many advancements have come. And now what they do is, if you want to trap other particles which are not having spherical shape, you attach that particular particle with the polystyrene bead and then you manipulate it along with that. You trap the bead along with that object to be studied. And not only trapping is done, manipulation of the object is possible too. And this is enhanced by tight focusing concept of optical singularities. Now the optical tweezers have been used to trap dielectric spheres, viruses, bacteria, living cells, organelles, small metal particles, and even strands of DNA. When they were used for study of DNA only, they became more important, and we were also able to study molecular motors. What do we mean by molecular motors? Inside our body, we have RNA polymerase, we have small motors like kinase, things like that. So these small motors are facilitating movement inside our body, and how much they move and how, what is the amount of power that they give to the next particle, how much they rotate actually, how many steps they take at a time, everything was studied only after the advent of these optical tweezers or optical traps. So this field is very, very important and is one of the most important applications of phase singularities in the beginning. And already we told about something like this, that it is enhanced by tight focusing. If you remember one of the earlier slides where we talked about the polarization, I also showed you that we have inhomogeneous polarizations possible. So in that case, inhomogeneous polarization, we saw two different structures. One is radially polarized light and the other one is azimuthally polarized light. Now, even though the optical tweezers helped a lot, they had one disadvantage along with that. What was the disadvantage? They were not able to study low refractive index particles. Why? Because when you are using focused light, then that focused light, when it traps the object, sometimes also damages the object. So we are not able to study the object properly. So what happens is, so in the figure that is shown below, you see that you have ordinary normal laser beam where the peak is shown, and you have two force gradients. One is the two forces acting on the particle. One is the force due to scattering of light from the particle, and the other one is the gradient force. One will be the force that is acting because of the light falling on the particle, and the other will be the force that is restoring force. So when this force and the restoring force balance each other, then the particle gets trapped. This is the normal, simple, in simple words, this is a concept actually. But when you are using the laser light, you see that you are using the peak. That is a peak intensity. So this is why the objects get damaged. So to overcome this problem, when they started studying about phase singularities and polarization singularities like radially polarized waves, when you are using these radially polarized beams, then they found that these radially polarized beams can be used for tight focusing. They come to a focus at like the focus point is very, very small compared to diffraction limited all the other focus points. So what happened here is the, you know that the beams, radially and asymmetrically polarized beams also have donut structure. So in that case, you will have the donut structure means what? You have an intensity null in the center. So this intensity null does not damage the object, and it facilitated the use of beams to study lower refractive index objects. And when you talk about focusing, when you use radially polarized light, when you focus radially polarized light, at the focal point you have intensity maximum. But when you focus asymmetrically polarized light, then at the focal point also you have the same donut structure. So at the same time you can study lower index particles also and higher index particles also with the use of polarization singularities as such. Not only it is like if you use laser beam, ordinary laser beam only, you can study high refractive index particles, and this will be useful only for low refractive index. Phase singularities and polarization singularities are used for studying both types of particles without damaging the particles, because at the center the intensity is null. And optical tweezers are very important, but the realization of optical tweezers is very, very difficult, because precise steering of the optical trap is accomplished with lenses, mirrors, acousto-optical devices that can be controlled via a computer, and it's actually a very, very complicated circuit, and it is very difficult to start with, but it has revolutionized or touched fields like biology, chemistry and physics all in the same manner, and has led to it has thrown light on new properties of objects that we already don't know. And the last but not the least is the optical vortex in microscopy. Optical vortices are put to use in different forms of microscopy. You know that microscopy is very, very important. Now you have nanoscopy also. And the dissolving power of microscopes has been going on, increasing. You would have studied about electron microscope, things like that, optical microscope, electron microscope. And now there are microscopes beyond our imagination, which can go and we can actually study in vivo and in vitro using microscopes. So I am just talking about two different microscopies which use phase singularities for their working. One is fluorescence microscopy, where an ordinary light, both the microscopies that we are going to talk about has won Nobel Prizes. And the first one is fluorescence microscopy. An ordinary light beam can be used to excite fluorescent molecules, while the ring-shaped OM beam, that is a donut beam, can be used to de-excite these molecules, except for those which fall in the dim center of the beam. This technique was pioneered by the Nobel laureate Stephen Hell, and this allows the resolving power to be very, very less than it has been ever since before that. And then we talk about stimulated emission depletion microscopy, which is called as STED in short. This is a super resolved fluorescence technique, which was honored with a Nobel Prize in 2014 in chemistry. But even though the Nobel Prize was in the field of chemistry, it has done a lot to the biological field or the life sciences field. It uses Gaussian beam for excitation, and donut beams, modes carrying OAM as depletion beams. Depletion beams are also called as erase beams, and they rely on free space beam shaping to precisely co-align these beams. Why do we require phase contrast techniques in microscopy? You will see that when you see this figure. This shows bright field imaging of live cell and the phase contrast imaging. You see that when you see the right side image, there is absolutely nothing visible properly in the left side image, which is bright field imaging. So this is why phase contrast imaging becomes very, very important. And for that, the phase singularities have done their part a lot. So I think I have justified why I called phase singularities as fascinating ones. I think you would have also found those applications to be fascinating, where they have not touched one single field. They have been useful in many different fields. So that is why I call phase singularities as fascinating phase singularities in my topic. And if you want more information about these phase singularities, you can refer to this book, which gives you lots and lots of information about polarized phase singularities also and polarization singularities also. Thank you. If you have any queries, you can mail to me at deepa_shankar@yahoo.com. Thanks a lot.